Good evening and welcome to this special CNBC Africa broadcast where we are discussing just how competitive South Africa is. Unfortunately, the short answer has to be not very competitive these days. And I'm sure Minister Rob Davies will have something to say. But from being number one in terms of competitiveness on the African continent, we are now talking about South Africa being number two on the World Economic Forum Global Competitiveness Index. And we're also sitting at number three, sliding from my peak, I think I saw, of about number 45. At the same time, on the World Bank Ease of Doing Business Index, South Africa's position has also been sliding. I don't think I want to talk about Nigeria. I don't want to talk about size, because we know it matters. So the question is, what went wrong? Well, I've got people here who are going to help me answer that question. Let me start. On the right, on my left, immediate left, is the Minister of Trade and Industry, Minister Rob Davies. Thank you for your time, Minister. We have right next to him, Abel Sithole. Abel is the Deputy Director, the Institute for Futures Research at the University of Stellenbosch here in Cape Town. Thank you, sir, for your time. Next to him is Dennis Dykes, who has sparred many times. He is Chief Economist at Nedbank. Thank you, Dennis, for your time and for hosting us here tonight. And last but not least, Felix Rateb. He is CEO of Sea Harvest. Thank you, Felix, for your time. Minister, I want to start with you because you're the custodian of South Africa's competitiveness to a degree, because your drive is to make sure that this country is as competitive as it can be, and South African companies are out there in the world exporting and bringing in business into the country. I've read out the stats about where South Africa stands. I don't want to go into why it went wrong. I want to understand from your perspective, when you analyze what needs to be done to get South Africa back to number one on the African continent and fend off Rwanda from being number two.
I think the first point I'd make is that while we need to look at these competitiveness reports from the World Economic Forum, the World Bank or others, these are not exact sciences. The rankings depend on how these indexes are constructed, what weight is given to the various factors. I think that when we look at competitiveness, we look at it in terms of where this economy needs to go and where it needs to build competitiveness in order to get it there. And the most important conclusion from where I'm sitting is that this country, along with the rest of the African continent, needs to move up the value chain. Mm. We need to actually add value to the mineral resources that we have. We need to industrialize. That is the common mantra of the African continent. So we do have an industrial base in South Africa, but what are the elements of supporting raising the competitiveness of manufacturing? Mm. I think that our industrial policy action plans, which we've been implementing since 2009, a number of the programs that we have in there are directly competitiveness raising related. For example, in the clothing sector, we have a clothing and textile competitiveness program where we provide support precisely for that industry to raise its competitiveness. Mm. We have a forum in the motor industry which is around raising competitiveness. And one of our key flagship incentive programs is called the Manufacturing Competitiveness Enhancement Program, mm. where we work with firms around specific investments, projects that they are going to be embarking on to raise their competitiveness. Mm. But if we look more generally at the South African economy, what are the constraints for manufacturing? I think that they are infrastructure deficiencies, mm-hmm. and within infrastructure, energy. We do not have sufficient, affordable energy resources available to support manufacturing. And that's why in this administration, we have singled out a very hard focus on energy and addressing the energy constraint. Mm. The other constraint is skills, mm. skills development, which is also an area where we try to link with all our programs skills development issues to support skills development of companies that are involved. And then the other one is we need to be building new competitive advantages.
Right.
There's the old adage about natural comparative advantage and competitive advantage, which you can build.
Yeah.
And one of those areas where we've got to build a competitive advantage is around the availability of important industrial minerals. We have important industrial minerals in this country, iron ore, platinum group metals, some precious metals. We have important rare metals as well. Mm-hmm. What we need to do is we need, and I can talk a bit more about how we see this taking place,
yes.
we need to be moving towards beneficiation yeah. or value addition
yeah.
around our mineral products. We have a number of ideas about this
yeah.
and a number of projects which we will be implementing
yeah.
in the course of this administration.
That certainly is going to be part of the conversation tonight. We'll come back to that. But I take the point that you make about obviously the methodology as well as the issues that are in that competitiveness report from the World Economic Forum. Another day you and I will sit down and talk about what else you want to see and perhaps the weightings that you want to see included in there. But I wanted to know, you've been implementing IPEP since 2009. What difference has it made in terms of making South Africa more competitive? And importantly, where hasn't it worked?
Well, I don't know whether our chairman would want to confirm this, but the clothing and textile sector in this country was bleeding and we faced a very serious risk that we would lose it. And we would have deindustrialization taking place. Mm-hmm. We changed the incentive program and introduced an element of competitiveness where we support the industry when it becomes competitiveness, when it has a program to enhance its competitiveness. Mm-hmm. I think what we've seen is we've seen a high degree of stabilization and even some employment growth mm-hmm. in that sector. Similarly with the other industries that I mentioned, the automotive sector, we have highly competitive plants.
True.
The Mercedes-Benz plant in East London, for example, has won on repeated years the JD Power Award for the best automotive export to the United States. Mm. We do have capabilities in manufacturing, and we have been trying to support the enhancement of those capabilities with many of our programs. Mm. That is one of our key objectives, because I think we've said that we cannot industrialize simply by defending the status quo. We've got to encourage companies to become more competitive. Mm. We do need to carve out the space for them to allow that to happen. So we have been defending the domestic market against floods of substandard, low-quality imported products. We've been trying to do that better than we've done it before. We've been using trade policy tools as well. But ultimately, it is about creating the conditions where the industry itself can raise its competitiveness. And then, as I said earlier on, addressing some of these cross-cutting constraints, energy, skills among them, and also creating a new competitive advantage around beneficiation.
Yeah. Dennis, let me come to you. I think it would be a very tight contest between you and Minister Davis in terms of doing a SWOT analysis on South Africa's economy, because you cover it as much as you have. But you have got license, at least for tonight, to challenge some of the ideas that he is saying, because he is presenting the case of a very competitive economy that has not slid backwards. But you are in the private sector. You work with companies and you help them craft the right policies in order to be able to be competitive in the world. Where are we getting it wrong? And is government getting it?
Yeah, look, it is a complex issue. I mean, clearly, if you look at the last 5 years or so since the financial crisis, obviously we got affected by the same things that affected a lot of other countries. But by the same token, we are running a very large current account deficit, which indicates there's something almost structurally wrong. There are many indications that we actually slid down the competitiveness table. For me, competitiveness is a little bit like, if you want to use a sporting analogy, you actually want to have a team that's well-trained, exercised, coached, managed. And then very clearly, if you want to become competitive, you've got to play against the right team. So
sure.
For me, it's all about external competitiveness as well as internal competition, effectively. And what worries me a bit about what the minister's saying is there's very much a protectionist type of element to government policy. I'm not a believer that there should be no government intervention, no government protection. But all the academic study that I see suggests that it should be limited to, you know, where you think you might actually develop a comparative advantage.
Yeah.
And it should actually only be over a limited time span. I agree with the minister that, you know, a number of the issues that he raised, that we don't have sufficient electricity, that the price of electricity has obviously risen very rapidly. If you look at since the crisis, the price of electricity has risen by 300%. You're a small manufacturer, and you were paying 5% of your budget on electricity. You're now paying probably 13%, 14%.
Absolutely.
So massive deterioration in terms of your overall competitiveness.
Yeah.
But more importantly, it's the security of energy and so forth. And there, I think we've made some fundamental mistakes. We've spent something like 300 billion rand on energy generating electricity, and we're actually producing less electricity than we did in 2007, in July 2007, which is baffling.
Yeah.
But my overall message would be that we need to actually bring in the private sector much, much more aggressively than we are at the moment.
Right. Yeah.
We need to open up to competition where it's warranted. And yes, limited government intervention, limited government protection where it's needed to get industry on its feet. For the example, the clothing industry, for example, I think.
We'll come back and we'll talk about those external things that we need to address and the internal ones that we need to address. Let me come to academia. Now, from academia, of course, it's much, much easier sometimes to look at these things because, you know, you're sitting from afar and you're observing everybody at work. And sometimes perhaps you do get a better view of where things are going. Abel, from the bottom of the Cape here in Cape Town, how do you see things? Is Dennis making the right comment in terms of what needs to be done in terms of involving the private sector more? And from the minister's perspective, obviously saying government is doing what it can within the constraints that it has.
Well, I think you start out with the fact that you're dealing with South Africa Inc.
Yes.
And what that means is that you do need to have combined effort from all the players. So you can't just say, well, we'll deal with the government in isolation to what the business does.
True.
And then you need to understand what the different roles of the different players are. I always find it interesting when people say that South Africa is not competitive. I say, well, South Africa can't really be competitive. Companies can be competitive. And sometimes I think that's the challenge that we enter into, thinking that the country can be competitive. I say, no. If you really want to understand how competitive a country can be,
right,
you must actually go down to look at the separate components of
the entity. You're saying it's not the coach, it's actually the players we should be competitive.
Well, you must make sure that the court is nice and green, and the referee plays fair, all those important things. But ultimately, the important thing is that the players have to go out there and play.
Yeah.
Now, what the government must do, and again, is understanding the different roles of the different players.
Yeah.
The government, yes, must set up the right policies, incentives.
Is it setting up the right policies, though? Because that's the key question that we are asking.
Well, I think it's a conversation. I think the minister will say, well, I am setting the right policies.
Yeah.
There are specific initiatives that have been taken by government to try and actually create an environment that is conducive to government, to the private sector actually being much more active and being more competitive. You might say, well, is IPEP good enough? Well, it might not be good enough, but it is there and it's providing an environment which I think is useful.
Useful or just useful?
Well, very useful is always welcome for business. Business will probably want to have it very, very, very useful.
Yes.
But ultimately, it is the job of businesses and business leaders to actually create And to take advantage of the environment that actually currently exists.
Yeah.
Yes, the string can always be stretched as much as you want it to be.
Yeah.
But it is also, that's why they get the salaries they get paid,
okay,
that they become much more creative,
yeah,
look for the opportunities, even in difficult environments.
Before I leave, I want to ask you, because you have critiqued the government to an extent, I want you to critique the private sector as well. Have they been able to take advantage in sufficient strength, if you like, in the environment that's been created by the government?
I would say not as much as I think. You can point out specific initiatives where government has tried to come.
I want the glaring examples where they're actually missing opportunities that are there.
The minister indicated, for instance, in aspects of manufacturing, targeting, for instance, the motor industry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Of course, the players in that space happen to be big players from outside of the country.
Mm.
But to what extent are South African players in that space taking the components environment, taking advantage of that?
Yes.
For instance, to give an example, we're the biggest producer of platinum. Mm. We should have cornered the market for catalytic converters in the world.
Absolutely.
Every catalytic converter that you buy anywhere in the world should, by origin, be of South African make.
Okay. I see the minister is nodding. let me go to Felix. Now, Felix, I saved you for last because we know that, the minister, as well as those guys in the academia, sit on very cushy, nice chairs. And you actually are in the field, though, as can be seen from your exertions, trying to get to work. How do you view the environment that the government has set out and established for South African companies to be able to take on their counterparts in the world? Dennis made a point about how China, at number 29 is higher than South Africa, but South Africa is not sitting too badly at number 2. Do you see enough in the environment that we have that enables you to take on the others fairly? If not, what is missing?
I think the easiest for me is to give an example, which is a real example. Post the 2008 financial crisis when Lehman collapsed, our company, about 70% of what we do is international. And we're highly exposed to the European Union. And right after that, we had the sovereign debt crisis. So we got hit very badly. When that happened, we had a massive inflow of funds into South Africa, strengthening of the exchange rate. So we as a business faced a crisis. Effectively, I think it's strengthened by 20-30%.
Sure. Caused by the market, though, not by the government.
No, it's market factors. Mm. So what do? You have to reinvent yourself. How do you reinvent yourself? I think the big issue, and this is where I agree totally with the minister, is beneficiation. So we had to move up the value chain. Mm. We had to reinvent ourselves and add maximum value in South Africa, which is what we did. What do you need to do that? Again, it's skills. you need to have the right skills. You need to be very quick in the market to be able to move. We reallocated our market mix. We were highly exposed to Southern Europe. We moved to Northern Europe, to Australia, where it wasn't as exposed. At least pricing in Northern Europe wasn't as exposed in Southern Europe.
Yeah.
And in Australia, the currency didn't correlate the same way as it did to the euro.
Yeah.
So we reinvented ourselves through that. And I don't think whilst infrastructure probably plays a role.
Yeah.
I think the bigger issue for us is support from government on the type of negotiations that the minister was involved with.
I was going to come through
on
that and actually
EPA.
Ask you if perhaps government could do a little more. And I'll tell you why. You look at the current Russia-Ukraine dispute and the tit-for-tat sanctions that have been imposed. We have seen the Russians banning agricultural imports from Europe, and we have seen the impact on European farmers. The noises you are hearing are that Brussels must do something, and Brussels is saying, we are thinking about it. We're going to find ways in which to help you. When that happens, does it make sense for government to step in and actually help you fight those who are outside that you're competing with?
I think government already has stepped in. As I've said, the minister was involved here with the negotiations with the EPA, with the European Union. I think most of the times everybody looks at it and says, we could have done more. The reality is that the two sides negotiating, and from both sides, I think you need to get more than you give, and the Europeans want more than what they'll give us. So the reality is that we are on both sides,
Felix,
as an exporter.
Felix, you're not complaining, right? The minister is right here. Tonight you have license. You're not complaining about government assistance and what government needs to do to make you even better than at what you do.
I think there are other issues that affect
us. Sure, let's
not
raise
necessarily
them.
I think it's up to, as the Minister said, it's up to your own organisation to be able to reposition your business to be able to compete globally. I don't think as South Africans we need to step back, put it this way. I don't think that someone from China or Brazil or Russia is going to be more competitive. It's your business model needs to be competitive.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you need to be able to adjust your business. I think the climate is important in terms of enabling you to get in access to those markets.
Yeah.
And what I'm talking about is, for example, when we had the strikes, the Marikana strikes.
Thank you for
raising. As an example, we had a situation where we had a strike. And now I'm going to a retailer, this retailer happened to be in Germany, to try and explain to them, look, we've got a strike and we will not be able to supply. Mm. And their answer was, to the buyer, can you please go to with him to South Africa and sort it out?
Yeah.
That was the German response. I mean, they don't understand those type of things. So I think it's the climate more than anything else. It's creating a climate where you, because it's brand South Africa we're selling out there.
Yeah. Absolutely. The Minister has been making furious notes here. I want to give you a chance to respond before we move on and tackle the next idea.
Well, let me just first of all say, you know, you were saying, was IPEP very good or good? Our own assessment is a modest one. We say that in the 5 years that we implemented IPEP, we think that we have shown that industrial policy, where it's carefully targeted and appropriately driven, works. That's the point. Now what we need to do is we need to raise the game.
Right.
That's what we need
and
to do.
And make it better.
We need to make it better. And we need to make it better, and I think that I perhaps would not agree with Dennis Dykes that we are too protectionist, but I also don't think that we need to open ourselves up and expose ourselves unnecessarily in a world where there is no industry or sector that operates, my knowledge, according to textbook free market principles. All of them are supported by their governments. All successful sectors are supported by their governments. All of them are defended by their governments. Issues of market access dealing with tariffs are no longer the name of the game. We're now dealing with matters of technical barriers to trade. Just look at the citrus black spot issue with the European Union at precisely the moment when we signed the economic partnership agreement negotiations. Where do we think we need to use our base externally to become more competitive?
Sure.
First part, the African continent.
Okay.
Most important emerging economies are actually using a strong domestic economy base as a leverage of growth and industrialization now. But colonialism divided the continent into 54 countries. Our domestic markets are too small. That is why we are supporting broadening regional integration beyond our existing regional communities, starting with the SADC-COMESA East African Community negotiations with an eventual destination of a continental FTA. But also recognizing that we're not going to be able to support intra-regional trade and the emergence of a market that's going to support industrialization of the continent if we do not also work on infrastructure and connecting up our economies one to another and also cooperate around industrial development.
Before you go, I have to ask you about SADC because you've just come from
I've just come from there.
Yeah.
That was exactly.
Is it all talk and you guys go there and come back with these nice sounding phrases and then practically on the ground we don't see much changing?
No, I think what you heard in SADC was a very interesting message. And the message is that not just South Africa sees a need for us to industrialize, the rest of the continent sees a need to industrialize. Mm-hmm. And they see a regional organization like SADC has to play a key role in that. And in fact, there's a sense that it hasn't done enough on that. And the ministers of trade and industry have all been sent back to accelerate the work on the industrial pillar. I mean, there's a couple of examples I can give there. KPMG.
Very quickly, if you can, Minister, because I want to tackle the other issues.
Yeah. Africa exports and exports $6 billion worth of coffee. That is turned into products outside of Africa worth $100 billion US dollars.
Yeah, I've heard that figure.
Most of that value chain is captured outside. Even table grapes, which we produce in South Africa, more than 60% of the value chain is captured outside, and I don't think much value addition takes place. Mm. How do we capture more of those value chains and move up? That's the name of the game, and how do we become competitive in doing that?
Yeah.
That's the name of the game. Now, I don't think indexes that talk about all sorts of other things are necessarily focused in the right way.
Indexes are very great for us, Minister, because they allow us to put these headlines that say the country is sliding down the ranks and therefore we must address X. One of the things we need to address...
It depends on what's in those indexes what the priorities are in those indexes.
One of those indexes, one of the issues that we need to address is the productivity debate. This has been going on for a while. Are South African workers as productive as they ought to be? Now, I was looking up how you get productivity before we came on to the debate. And I saw that they say that as your economy advances, productivity is supposed to also increase. Mm. Are we seeing it in South Africa? If we are not seeing it, what is the problem? Let me start from the right coming inside.
It depends how you look at productivity. I mean, you can automate and be productive.
No, you are on the shop floor because you know, you should be seeing it.
So we've decided to... We employ a lot of people, and we also buy into the policy in terms of creating jobs. So we haven't chosen to automate, but I think you can get a lot out of your workers if you build the trust and you train people properly. So I wouldn't, and I visit a lot of factories around the world, I wouldn't say our workers are any less productive than anywhere else in the world. Perhaps we're not as automated.
That's a big statement, right?
Pardon?
It's a big statement.
Well, at least we've been, you know.
Because you, at least, you've got people that you're employing and you can see the productivity on a daily basis.
Like for like, you can compare. So I don't think it's a level of automation, I think, where it is different, and investment in industries. I mean, you go to factories in Germany, they're very, very different. They operate with 5 people in the whole factory. Mm. We would be, let's say, 400 people in our factory.
Okay.
So that's not comparing apples with apples.
Dennis?
Yeah, look, it's a really big topic, but I mean, fundamentally, obviously, it comes down to education, the general education system. The minister's right. You want to move up the value chain, but clearly you want to actually have workers that can actually that facilitate that, and
who
management
are more productive?
That facilitates
I'll
that.
Put it in for you. Who are more productive?
No. I think it's not only that. It's also management's role to actually help workers be skilled workers and make them more productive. So it's a much more complex factor there. And then of course. Absolutely, you have to have the right capital equipment and technology. The difficulty we face with is that we've got a very, very significant portion of the population that's relatively unskilled.
Sure.
And, I mean, clearly one of the mantras that you hear in the academia certainly is that you want to actually create jobs for those people rather than create jobs for people that we don't actually have.
Absolutely.
And I think that's a very big challenge.
Yeah, and he's right there.
Well,
we need him to answer
that's quite important because I think we like to be, we wish we were in a different country with a different demographic, and that would be nice.
But is the generalization that we are not as productive as we ought to be right? If not,
I think Felix was correct. I think you, the challenge for South Africa is that sometimes we are productive in terms of mechanization, but that productivity is such that you're finding that it doesn't actually service our type of demographic. Mm-hmm. So for the small group of people who are skilled, that can actually operate in an environment that requires the skill, we're actually doing very, very well.
Mm.
But as a country, that's not the only challenge that we're facing. The biggest challenge is the other people that, no matter what you do, you won't be able to bring up to speed in terms of their skillless level. So you need to have the kind of activity that actually services them and not just only the one side of the population. So I think Dennis is quite correct.
Yeah.
You need to look at productivity from that perspective. Yeah. I think South Africa is very productive,
right,
but not for our people necessarily.
Minister, would you agree?
No, I would say that where workers are properly trained, where they are properly organized through management systems and so on, South African workers are as productive as any others anywhere in the world.
Are we making politically correct statements?
The problem that we've got is that we come from a past where we were a mining economy that required large numbers of unskilled people, and there was no investment in skills development and training. That was the historical basis and the legacy of apartheid. So we've got many, many people who've been expelled from those opportunities who are unskilled in our country, and the way forward has to be that we need to raise the levels of skills and education in an economy which is in a world where actually there is a massive replacement of many, many routine tasks by ICT-driven processes. That's what we've got. That's the challenge.
Mm.
And it's no small challenge. It's no easy challenge. But ultimately, it's a challenge that we cannot afford not to confront.
Absolutely. And we have to confront. You want to add in quickly before we go to the break?
In terms of productivity or being competitive, we haven't touched on scale. You know, you need economies of scale and scale to compete globally.
Yeah,
and I think many times, you know, the more fragmented an industry gets, the less competitive you are.
Yeah,
it's something that the Americans have realized. I mean, they're big and they can go and dominate another market and sell to another market. And I think that's one of the things. You become more competitive when you have better economies of scale.
Right, and this is where, of course, the government comes in and its effort integration becomes a reality and helps to companies grow and build the economies of scale that you want to.
But very importantly, that means that you're not going to be producing everything. So I think the point I was making a bit earlier on, where cheaper imports exist or inputs that exist out there, take advantage of it. You know, become more competitive through those.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, my one criticism I'd have with IPAP is that it sort of covers almost like 80% of our industry. So it's a little bit diversified, if I might put it that way.
Absolutely. Thank you for joining us in the first half of this debate, where we have been trying to analyze South Africa's competitiveness and indeed if there are areas where South Africa ought to focus on in order to be able to become more competitive. When we come back in the second half, we want to examine who is as competitive as they ought to be and perhaps importantly, how do we get to compete against other nations by increasing exports to those other parts of the world who are perhaps bringing in their imports into this country. Don't go away. Welcome back. You're watching this special CNBC Africa report where we're discussing South Africa's competitiveness. And I've got with me here the Minister of Trade and Industry, Minister Rob Davies. I also have Ebo Stole from the University of Stellenbosch and Dennis Dykes from Nedbank, as well as the CEO of Sea Harvest, and his name is Felix Rateb. And we are trying to find out answers to South Africa's problems. Now, one of the issues that you face when you talk about South Africa's competitiveness is who is exporting out of South Africa and how many are there? I saw a World Bank report that said that out of 93% of South Africa's exports actually comes from just 1,000 firms. The other 20,000 firms that do export make up the other 7%. Minister, the question is, how do we scale up those 20,000 firms to be able to create more out of the value of products and services that are taken out of the country?
Well, I think, first of all, you might want to ask who are the small number of large exporters. Mostly they are in the raw materials, primary product sector. That is the position we continue to occupy in the global economy, or fundamentally there as producers and exporters of primary products. The others are the ones where the transformation and growth needs to take place. Those are the producers of value-added products. I think that our view is that the first instance we must become competitive and we must be players on the African continent. That is where we can learn and that's where we can start. That is already where South Africa is active. But of course, as other countries on the African continent industrialize, we've got to create space for them in our market, as well as move up, I think, the value chain even on the African continent.
Yeah, but Minister, talk a little about the other work that you're doing around actually taking South African companies and delegations around the continent.
I was going to say, beyond that, it has been our role as government to seek out dynamic economies across the world and to create and open opportunities for South African producers, particularly value-added products. For example, with China, we export primary products to China. That's what our export basket is dominated by. Theirs is value-added products. We have agreed with them that they should support us we've identified 10 value-added products, and we've been showing and promoting these value-added products in China.
How was that conversation?
The conversation has been quite tough, but it's also been quite effective. And we've seen, for example, the wine industry has taken huge advantage of that. We have, in the framework of the BRICS, we've conducted a study based on revealed comparative advantage of products, value-added products that can be supplied into each other's markets. And we adopted that at the last BRICS summit, which was held in Fortaleza in Brazil. We've been working quite energetically with countries in the Gulf, where there are huge opportunities for a range of also agricultural products as well as value-added products. And we've been looking for dynamic opportunities in all kinds of places. Russia, we have identified the Russian market as an alternative to many companies that are finding themselves stuck in one or other difficulty in the EU, not least because the EU market hasn't grown and our exports to Europe haven't grown. But we also open up some more space there. The economic partnership agreement negotiations, we open up space for sugar, for wine, for ethanol. There's a new industry which we can take advantage of, as well as better terms for a number of our fruit products. Those are all contained in the economic partnership agreement negotiations. We continue to try to ensure that we have favorable terms under the African Growth and Opportunity Act in the United States.
Yeah.
I was just there recently, and I think that things are looking reasonably positive that South Africa will continue to be included in the African Growth and Opportunity Act. We are the biggest user of the African Growth and Opportunity Act across the board, including a fair proportion of value-added products.
Let me ask a sensitive question, Minister. The perception when you go into the continent sometimes is that South Africa is playing big brother, and sometimes South African companies come in and they flood local markets and they take over, and there's resentment against that. Now, you go in there promoting South African products. What kind of reception are you getting?
Well, there is that perception. And sometimes that perception is based on one or other predatory practice by some South African company. And I think that what we say to every other South African company is whatever brand you may carry, however protective you may be of your brand, whether you like it or not, you carry another brand, that's brand South Africa. And we need to jealously guard the integrity of that brand. If somebody has dumped some date-expired product on one or other country, you'll be amazed how many years later that incident is mentioned in discussions we have with other governments. We need to be supporting other countries as well in a more developmental role in the African continent and gain a reputation for our companies as working with integrity to support development on the continent as a whole. That's something that's a challenge for us.
How do we mix this developmental role with the hard cases of doing business on the continent, competing against everybody else who's coming onto the continent? Let me quickly sweep through our panelists here. Abel?
Well, I mean, just take for instance, we just spoke about AGOA, where the US has deliberately made it possible for us to trade in certain goods, as the minister has indicated.
Yeah.
Now, South Africa being the biggest economy on the African continent, why can't we have a SAGOA of our own, where we actually do something very similar to other markets in on the continent, if we believe in the regional integration, where we deliberately say we will make it easier for you to... Because normally, as a country, we would automatically want us to be able to be trading with them and not necessarily them trading with us. So what we need to actually actively do is to actually now open ourselves for them to trade with us.
That's an interesting
idea. And take
idea.
Advantage of the capabilities that we've built in. For instance, talk about industrialization. Yeah. Why aren't we the China of Africa, where instead of the raw materials going into China, the raw materials come into South Africa to be beneficiated back into Africa.
I mean, absolutely.
That to me is an idea.
That's an interesting idea. Dennis, what do you think? And I also want to get your idea, Phillips.
Yeah, look, I think there's always, when you've got countries competing against
each other. Is it viable, though?
Excuse me?
Is it viable, what you suggest?
I think it is, yes. You know, when you've got countries on very different levels of development and you suddenly open tariff barriers and you open up non-barriers, which in our case often is infrastructure.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly... the ones that are less developed are going to be less advantaged. So, so I think there is a case for, you know, as I said, there are cases where intervention is warranted. I think that is a case, and but again, it should actually have a time expiry date on it.
Is government hand welcome here, Felix?
Are they welcoming?
Yeah, like in facilitating this AGOA type arrangement that Abel
was
talking
about. I think so. I think that, you know, it depends on. I reckon what type of industry you're in.
Yeah.
So, you know, on this one with the minister, I'd have a slightly differing view in terms of the BRICS. I think we find it quite difficult to do business in those countries, difficult in terms of access. You take 2 years to send a sample, as an example. So even though it's open, it's supposedly open, but there's
so
much bureaucracy.
Are those market difficulties or official in the sense, you know,
there
are...
a lot of bureaucracy, so it's kind of difficult to get into those markets. So while they talk openly, it's actually difficult to do business there. So we find ourselves... If you take the view that you're moving up the value chain, you have to charge more for your products.
Mm-hmm.
So if you where are you going to go? You land up again going to the developing world.
Because
the US with the AGOA negotiation, the EU, it's open for business and it's quite easy to do business. Whereas I think with the BRICS, we struggle.
But
I don't know what anyone...
I think the minister wants to respond.
Can I just come in on one thing? I mean, there was this debate even in the United States.
Yeah.
Why is it that there's not a broader use of the trade openings that exist? Because even under the SADC trade protocol, there's a bigger opening, hypothetically, than South Africa has in many other countries. And it came into force earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the issues are really, and ultimately, at the end of the day, supply capacity. And also infrastructure, the ability to produce goods that are going to be competitive on the South African market.
Mm-hmm.
Very seldom are those to do with there's a tariff in place.
Yeah.
Much more to do with whether there's the productive capacity in other countries. That's why the pillar on industrial development was emphasized in SADC. We need to be looking at regional value chains, and we need to be looking at what does it take for other countries to get in the regional value chains.
Yeah.
And eventually, I think we're going to have to accept as South Africa that there will be products which we produced locally or we even exported into other countries locally,
yeah.
which we must expect them to be producing and exporting into our market while we move up the value chain.
But what about the issue he raises around bureaucracy? So he is capable, he's got a product that is able to sell it into that market, but he is finding frustration from bureaucracy.
We do know these are things called technical barriers to trade. I think we do know in some of the BRICS countries those are issues. We raise those issues on behalf of South African business. We raise them, I think, in a way which we want to say, let's emphasize in building relations complementarities. Mm-hmm. Let's try to identify areas where we're not going to be, we're all industrializing. We could end up having a huge competitive battle if we all push to get into each other's markets, or we can build a relationship built on complementarities. We've decided to go that route and open up that conversation with other BRIC countries. It's not immediately obvious that everything is going fine and dandy, but that's the direction that we're pushing in. And I think it's very, very important that we are in this club called BRICS, because it does enable us to raise these matters with some of the most important dynamic emerging economies in the world.
So we're addressing the external as well as the internal issues that ought to be addressed in trying to make sure we are more competitive. Let's talk about the other big one. The cliche is the elephant in the room, labor. So according to the Global Competitiveness Index from the World Economic Forum, of the 148 countries that they surveyed, I don't think anyone wants to jump in and give me the answer where South Africa ranks. It's one number 148.
45.
So out number 148 out of 148. Now, we saw at the weekend President Jacob Zuma signing into law amendments to the Labor Relations Act. Are those amendments enough to take away the pain that we have seen? Commentary I've seen suggests that we might have about 2 or 3 years of relative calm. Number one, because we've seen a number of multi-year agreements being signed within various sectors of the economy. And number two, because this is for the first time being addressed by government. President Jacob Zuma said he does not want South Africa to be known as strike country. Let me begin with you, Felix.
Look, I think it's one of the big issues that we need to deal with. It affects your business globally. Brand South Africa is affected. You can't supply to those economies. You can't get your service levels right. Mm-hmm. But it's not only government. I think as employers, one needs to build trust with your employees. I think that trust doesn't exist in South Africa between the employer and the employee. Mm-hmm. So you have to embark on a process where you build that trust, mm-hmm. And hopefully the environment is such that you're able to harness that so that you can have decent relations with your employees. A company cannot survive without its employees.
Absolutely.
So you have to have that dialogue, and I would hope that going forward that dialogue would be, you know, a dialogue that you can go in the same direction, because I think right now it's heading the opposite direction. That's the bigger problem.
Absolutely. Dennis, let me come to you. I'm sure your boys have done some research around that Labor Relations Act, the amendments that have been pushed through. Is that a turning point, do you think?
Look, I don't think so, to be honest. I don't think that it's all to do with legislation, and you know, I don't think that what we've seen is necessarily sufficient. There's no doubt, though, that if I go back to my team analogy, this is one of the own goals that we score time and time again.
Absolutely, unfortunately.
Because you basically project the image that you're an unreliable part of the supply chain. And foreign investors just absolutely hate that. So it hits foreign direct investment very significantly, and it hurts, of course, local investors as well.
Yeah,
it's really a conversation I think that we have to have, and we have to try and actually come up with some sort of cohesive agreement.
Yeah.
That looks more broadly at the whole issue.
Yeah. Abel, I see you are smiling, because I'm going to come to you and ask you, actually, because you would have more time to think about this than anybody else. And I'm not saying anything about your I'm not saying anything about your productivity, because that is where you get measured. How do we get this dialogue going? A few months ago, I asked one of the CEOs I was interviewing whether there has been enough in terms of the private sector reaching out to the black workforce and saying to the black workforce, we know where we're coming from. We are 20 years into democracy. We have not made enough strides to reach out and sit down together and understand each other, now is the time. And then people start talking about that CODESA type summit. How do we start?
Well, I think labour is a constituency that's very important in South Africa.
And is very angry.
And why is it angry?
Right.
So that's the first thing. And we need to understand the basis of that anger. But more importantly, I think Felix kind of touched on it, but just to reemphasize it, I think the relationship between labour and the other side of labour, which is the employers, that's what it is. Sometimes people say, well, it's the relationship is between labor and the government because the labor has a close relationship with the government. Yes,
I was
it
going
does.
To add another leg as
but,
well.
But
and
before
say
you
government
can get there with
legislation,
the relationship between labor is between labor and the employer. And one needs to actually construct a very constructive engagement between those two. Mm. And employers can't outsource the management of their labor to somebody else.
Well, can government help?
Well, the government is an important stakeholder. I mean, it sets the policy environment within which this relationship plays out. But ultimately, the engagement actually takes place between the two. And I think in South Africa over the last couple of years, we've become quite comfortable as employers to outsource the engagement of our employees to other people.
While making our millions.
And then we are surprised when we don't understand them and they don't understand that because there's no conversation. And I mean, labor is not... It's not stupid.
So who needs to take the first step to get this dialogue going?
I think, well, what is the contractual relationship? It's between the employer and the employee. That's where things have to start and actually be constructed much more better than I think they currently are.
Yeah.
Then you have to go and say, does our current legislation actually provide for that and how does it do it? But I think there's been a shunning of the acceptance. Mm. We get labor and the employers.
It ought to start at the workplace.
Yes.
Minister, you want to contribute before
I
mean, we are?
I think that I would say that we have in South Africa, we passed through an extraordinary labor relations episode, particularly in the mining industry, with a lot of factors, I think, at stake there. One of the things that I think we need to avoid as a country is every time we have a strike, we think that there's going to be a repetition of a five-month strike in the platinum sector. And I think we shoot ourselves in the foot because we send that message out. And it's not like that very often. We are a country that recognizes the right to strike. It's in our constitution. That's not going to change. That means from time to time there will be strikes. Many of the strikes are quite normal and are factored in, I think, in many industries. Having said that, I think that the issue is we've got to rebuild the coherence of the collective bargaining system. That's the only way we can work in this country. There's no other solution that's in place. And I do think that all parties have to be part of this.
Yeah.
And one of the other things is there has to be
should we check it out? Should
visible?
We check it out, Minister?
I think that
some people are suggesting that it's not good. It's not good for the small firms.
I think that if you think that we can just deal without any kind of regulated collective bargaining system in this country, I think you are on a hiding to nowhere, and you're going to see a series of wildcat strikes all over the place, and that's going to be the outcome. But what I was going to say is the other element, which I think is got to be critical, is there has to be visible fairness and gain sharing. And I think that in cases where you don't see that, we have these outbreaks. I mean, how can it be that companies come up and they say that they can't afford this and this and this percentage, and too often workers can come out and say, well, actually all the CEOs and the bosses are getting a much bigger percentage increase in the bonuses and everything else, and actually they're not wrong about that. I think those are the kind of issues that we've got to deal with. We are a society which is hugely unequal, and I think that we've got to address those inequalities as well. Basically create an atmosphere in which there is a sense that we're all in the same team. And I think that there's some really, really big challenges.
Yeah.
I don't think there's a silver bullet, and certainly there's no silver bullet which says, let's get rid of the Labour Relations Act, let's stop people's right to strike and things like that. If you try to move in that direction, I think what you get is you wouldn't get less strikes, you get more strikes.
Absolutely. So we need to rethink our labour relations environment and also rethink the social compact and rebuild it, because certainly it does appear broken. Well, it's time for us to open the debate to the floor. As I said, please identify yourself, the organisation that you represent, and if you can, as quickly and as succinctly as possible, give us your point of view and who you're directing the question to. The floor is open. There are roving mics around. If you raise your hand, they will find you and we'll get this conversation going. I think many important points have been raised here and some very contentious ones as well. I would say that perhaps the labor relations one is the biggest one. I think perhaps we need government beginning by summoning everyone to a summit and banging heads together. And then if no one listens, certainly perhaps imposing it. I don't know. It's just my view. Do we have anyone with a burning question, burning comment? There is a hand right here. Is that, you've got the microphone, and then we come to this gentleman here.
Thank you very much. My name is,
go ahead.
My name is Chris Whelan. I'm with a group called Accelerate Cape Town. Just on the labor relations thing, the question I would have is, given that government is, in fact, also engaged with unions, in fact, they're in the government together with the unions, is there not an immediate conflict of interest that, you know, we're saying we should be more competitive? How is the minister and how is the government going about both being the rulemaker and, in fact, of course, being reliant on labor for its votes? It strikes me that that's an immediate conflict of interest.
The political alliance minister.
Well, I mean, I think that, of course, there are governments around the world that have constituencies based on labor. Many of them are in government and in all kinds of countries around the world. Of course, when you are in government, you're also an employer. The government has to engage in negotiations with its own employees, as well as government has a role to play in the determination of the labor relations framework. I don't think there's a conflict of interest. We stand for the interests of the majority of the people of this country, and that includes working people.
Okay. We've got another question here.
Yeah, hi, my name's Joseph. I'm from CB Education. My question is directed, I think, more so to Dennis and probably the minister as well. The question is, it kind of feeds into the question asked just now, around the relationships that government has and the kind of decisions that they have to make based on the interests of various parties on hand. My question around the industries that we decide to protect or decide to invest in as government and have moving forward, I do agree that in some cases it might be too broad based on the various interests that we try and balance. So the question being, really, how much more specific does it need to get? You know, basically, how incorrect is it right now? Probably more from you, Dennis. Like, how would you evaluate the investment that government is currently making into industry?
Yeah.
Look, I mean, I think the ministers indicated a bit early on that you want to actually give temporary protection to industries that might have a revealed advantage. So it's the old infant industry type of argument where you feel that for example, we were chatting before the show that maybe we might have a comparative advantage when it comes to something like platinum converters, you know. And then government protects it for a while, but it's a temporary protection, and basically it's lifted after that period of time. You might also, for example, like the clothing industry example that was given a bit earlier on as well, you might want to offer some protection to an industry that is clearly has to adapt very quickly and try to actually reinvent itself in a very big way. Mm. And there's a case for that to be made.
Yeah.
What you don't want, I think, is just, you know, barriers to be thrown up and every industry is protected, because one must bear in mind that there's a cost to this. The cost is basically the consumer.
Yeah.
The consumer's paying more, which means there's less money in the pocket to go and spend at the restaurant, there's less money in the pocket to spend on the service industry. Yeah. And on other industries, other local industries that might be actually more competitive.
Yeah.
So it's not a cost-free way of actually trying to industrialize your economy. You've got to be very circumspect about it.
Yeah. Minister, what's the government thinking? Well, what's the philosophy that drives government to say, we want to pick this one, we won't pick this one, we'll protect this one, we won't protect this one?
You see, sometimes people say industrial policy is about picking winners. And the government is going to sit down and say that this is where the industry can grow and this is where it's going to no longer grow. We haven't actually taken that view. Rather, we would say we want to work with winners that have been identified. And many of those winners are found across the different sectors of manufacturing. It's not that they just found in some parts of manufacturing and are found in others. Mm-hmm. Having said that, we have identified a number of opportunities sectorally. industries that are going to produce inputs into the infrastructure program. A lot of those industries, those are capital goods industries, transport equipment industries, metal industries, industries which, as we've been taking procurement decisions as government that we will buy from local sources and using the space available to us, have actually begun to take off. Green industries, making the move towards a greener economy, something which is also going to support industrial development. But I think let me say something about building an industry based on the competitive advantage that we have of mineral products, platinum. Mm. It's not just catalytic converters, it's jewelry, and very excitingly, it's fuel cell technology that can be used to create small power stations. Now, one of the things that we will be doing is we will be putting to the new board that's about special economic zones a proposal to establish one, maybe two, special economic zones based on the platinum sector, based on using those products. And then I think we've got to actually then confront some very difficult issues.
Yeah.
If we go into those special economic zones and we base ourselves on value addition on platinum, is the platinum that's going to be made available to support those industries, is it going to be at the London Metal Exchange price, and there's going to be no price competitive advantage for the industries in South Africa, or is there going to be a competitive price for those mineral products? That's going to be a big issue. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that I think that really the question is that we deploy supportive measures. We are not just raising tariffs across the board. Where there are industries and there's a tariff in place and it's covering some input which the industry needs in order to move up the value chain, we've removed the tariffs, rebates. We have many, many rebates in the tariff book as well. So I think that it's about using these things where the evidence tells us we can get some real benefit in terms of industrial development and job creation.
Did you engage with industry when you decide on those industries that you want to protect?
Of course we do. We develop a program for each industry, and that's based on extensive consultation. We have extensive consultation with manufacturers in all kinds of forums, and in fact we want to deepen those conversations.
Okay, we've got some more questions. There's a gentleman here. There's another one and another there. Okay, let's start with you, sir. We don't have a microphone. Who's got a microphone? Is there anyone with a microphone? No, the microphone is not with anyone. Okay, he's got it, and then we come to you, sir. Can we move the microphone to this gentleman? Go ahead, sir.
Okay, good evening to all. My name is Riza Amdele, and I am with Islamia College. And my question tonight is aimed more at Minister Davies, and that is, how does the NDP enable South Africa's competitiveness?
Thank you. I actually had one of my questions, but...
How does it enable? I didn't hear what the last one.
How does the NDP enable South Africa's competitiveness?
Okay.
You want to take that one, Minister?
Yes, okay, fine. Well, I think the NDP
that.
Deals with a huge number of issues, not just in the economy, but it does also deal with raising competitiveness in the economy. It does identify competitiveness raising as a critical issue. I've mentioned a few of the elements that we see as barriers to competitiveness in this economy, very specific. I think some of those are covered in the NDP itself. And it also provides us with, I think, a general vision that all of us can relate to to build the kind of consensus about where this economy is going. I think that's one of the important roles that the NDP can play in this regard.
Thank you, Minister. Someone has got a microphone there? No? He's got it. Please give him the
thank
microphone.
Thank you, Godfrey. TJ Tapela from Brimstone. Minister, how? What sort of priority are we placing on beneficiating, as it were, a naturally endowed sector like tourism, not just for South Africa, but for the region, is a foreign exchange earner.
Well, the minister is hogging all the questions here.
I know. And you talk about beneficiation. I thought you were going to talk about adding value to mineral products or agricultural products. I mean, that is the focus on manufacturing. But tourism is an area where we have huge potential. And I mean, there's a promotion of tourism, and South Africa has a lot of advantages for tourism. Mm. But I think that just to get the linkage between manufacturing and value addition and tourism, there have been a lot of studies that have shown that if your tourism sector is reliant on imports, the benefits to your local economy of that tourist sector are much, much less than if you are actually producing the inputs that are required and consumed by tourists when they come here. And I think South Africa is in a very good position to build its tourism. We've got just to convince a few people that we don't have Ebola and that there's no reason why they should stay away. That is something which is fairly current at the moment. But actually, tourism visits to South Africa have been growing and growing significantly. It does show it's a very, very important sector.
Okay. You want to contribute, Dennis?
Yeah. You know, I think it does bring up another issue, though, that is sometimes one ministry is actually supporting an industry like Department of Trade and Industry, and then another ministry like Home Affairs is doing something else with biometric testing and basically threatening the tourism industry. So, you know, I think it's very, very important that a consistent face is given by government, and that the economic impact of every policy is actually assessed from a holistic point of view. Otherwise, it can lead to all sorts of issues.
In your view, Dennis, do you think there's enough conversation going on between government and private industry when it comes to picking those sectors where protection goes, or perhaps picking those areas where effort ought to be made to try to make the country more competitive?
I think it's a very difficult conversation, you know, for a sector to go to government, because, I mean, clearly every sector will want protection. It's like a complete no-brainer because it gives you sort of monopolistic type of powers.
Sure.
I think probably where the conversations take place is more on a firm level, but the minister's in a better sort of place to actually affirm that or not.
Tariffs are set in South Africa by the International Trade Administration Commission. It has to receive inputs not from government departments but from industry players. They make a case, and the mandate to them is they've got to consider the evidence. They put a proposal out for comment, and there's comment the other way. Mm. And only then do they make a recommendation which comes to government. And most of the time, I sign these things off. Most of the time, we sign them off on their recommendations. So there is a significant amount of consultation.
There's a mechanism. Engagement. You want to add, Felix?
I just wanted to add that I would imagine the priority should be where it protects jobs.
Absolutely. Protects jobs, creates productive capacity in the country, and those are the issues.
Okay. If there are more questions, yeah?
When the minister started the topic, it immediately struck me that the learners will be retrenched before they impact into the workplace. Because as soon as workers hear this thing about increase our productivity, we know as unions what it means. Now, if you exclude as government, if you exclude role players, that is what's happening now. For example, the unemployed, the disabled, the unions, for that matter. If you exclude it, the missing link will remain as to what the government needs what to do is in fact detrimental to any planning that they are doing, because GEAR has been quite, everybody knew what GEAR did, and this is the problem. If we are excluded as organized labor in planning the economy of this country, because make no mistake about it, Minister, that the government cannot talk for business. Because business is the people that in fact they are in the business of making money, and this is what we want to bring clear, and to make clear that there is no protectiveness and protective mechanism, and that is to prevent as to what will happen if productivity is at the order of the day where it needs to increase.
Okay, I think you make your point very well, Minister.
I can only agree.
I think you have agreed with him.
I can only agree. In some cases, let me just cite the clothing textile sector. The union sector has been one of the most important parties in terms of identifying the opportunities and direction for that sector to move in. So I can only agree, labour is an important part of the conversation.
Absolutely. Let's pick that gentleman there at the back.
Minister, we have spoken about it before, but I'd also like to extend it to the rest of the panel. Talking about South Africa's growth, we know that China individually is the biggest trading partner, and in terms of region, it's Europe. What is being done to promote intra-Africa trade? It's very low levels at this stage. Minister, what on your side is being done, and to the rest of the panel, what do you see as the key constraints in terms of promoting intra-Africa trade? Thank you.
Good. contribute as
We've
well?
We've got to promote large regional markets, and I said we were broadening free trade areas across existing regional communities, culminating in a continental FTA, which is the AU's project. But we've got to complement that by building the infrastructure that links up our economies. Most of the infrastructure on the African continent is built to take some raw material to the port and then out of the region. And then we've got to cooperate to build and boost the productive capacity of many African countries and their economies. I think those are the three elements that need to come together.
Anyone wants to add?
The other issue that really raises the cost of inter-trade is corruption at border posts, corruption at way stations and so forth. Delays at border posts, all those sort of things make a huge difference and makes it very, very difficult.
Yeah, Dennis, you don't want to start me on that one in the amount of hours I spend at the border post. And I'm sure there are many other examples here. There's a gentleman here, and then we come here.
I am.
Is it working?
I am Siraj Taufi from Bespoke Media. I'm going to say something quite unpopular probably, but we have April, and it's about productivity. The whole month of April is riddled with public holidays. Is there any way of addressing the public holiday policy within this country? Because we have a situation where public holidays fall on a Sunday and it gets put onto a Monday. We have more public holidays than a lot of other countries. In the United States, if a public holiday falls on a Tuesday to a Thursday, it gets moved to a Friday or a Monday to give you a long weekend, but it doesn't disrupt the entire week with people taking other weekends in between. It's a simple question, but I just wanted to address that.
We spend too much time on our backhand. There's no business in April, Minister, I think.
Well, sometimes we get into a silly situation where if Easter's in March, then suddenly we say, oh, everything's collapsed in March. And then everything's got better in April because there's no Easter in April, and vice versa. I think that the public holidays were the subject of a lot of discussion. Many of those public holidays are public holidays that are there for very important national reasons. I can't imagine anybody's going to say we shouldn't celebrate April the 27th. I can't imagine too many people are going to want to give up Easter. I think we just have to live with public holidays. I don't think we have an extraordinary amount of public holidays.
Could we rearrange them in such a way that we're able to cut down the amount of time
I don't know. I mean, April the 27th is April the 27th, and you must ask people how Easter's determined. I don't know.
Okay, let's give that. Oh, yeah, we've got him here.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Fred Robertson, Chairman of Brimstone Investment Corporation and CEO of us as well as House of Monatic. Minister, I want to thank you for the incentives in the clothing industry. We have long been soldiers in the clothing industry and keeping our workers there, and I think your incentives has done wonders to stabilize the industry. And I think that us from this region need to give our government and our minister a round of applause for just keeping all those workers in place. So please, would you do that to us?
Thank you, sir.
I think it's important. But, Minister, you're not going to get away with that lightly. we do export our wool in raw form. And then when we have to re-import a very good textile, our local textile manufacturers have a protection, and there's tariffs there. So we are clothing manufacturers, and we have brands like Kaduchi and House of Monatic, and we do need a very good international textile to actually make a very good suit. I was most encouraged with your incentives that our people could, when I heard from them, I spoke to them last week, they were in Kenya, in Tanzania, they were selling our suits out there. These were suits that previously went into Europe. So we're also doing the regional thing.
You want protection?
No. we want that same. We export raw wool.
That's fine. You
can. And then we re-import the textile, the material.
Right.
And we want that portion, a deduction of the portion of that tariff. And I think that should be addressed, Minister. So I leave that with the Minister can address that. But I also want to talk about local competitiveness, about bringing young people into business. And here, Dennis Dykes, you with the bank, you know how difficult it is for a young person to open a business account. I'm sure if he went for a microloan, he could get it in 2 seconds. But to open a business account for a young person who wants to go into business is most difficult. I think there's also a difficulty at Cipro to register a business. So we've got to make clear those playing fields so that we can get younger people into business, and they will then be our future global business people and exporters. Mm. So, Minister, it is an issue about the wool. Sure. It is an issue about Cipro. Dennis Dyke, there is a question to you and to carry over to the bank as to how to just make business banking a lot easier. Mm. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Minister, you want to respond? Well, I think Dennis may still compel.
Quickly, the textile manufacturers or the clothing manufacturers have never agreed what is an input into another. I know there is this argument about, well, we don't have a big, large textile industry. Can we now not have a rebate scheme or a reduction in the duties on the textile products?
Yeah.
And I think there are a number of formulas that could be considered, but I think it would be an inclusive conversation that takes on board the industry as a whole. I mean, not close to that discussion, but I think that the industry itself must get together and we reach a common understanding. Mm. Let me just say, I think that Fred's a little bit behind. We don't have anything called Cipro any longer. We have something called the Companies and Intellectual Property Commission. Okay. And I was just
someone
at
was
a seminar.
The,
no, no.
Someone was saying the name changes too often.
No, no, no. let me just say, I think that people are not understanding the changes that have been made. You can walk into a bank, and it's not Dennis's bank, unfortunately. Hopefully, his bank will come on board. But you can walk into a bank, you can open a business bank account, and you can be connected online to the CIPC account, and you can register business and pay 175 Rand.
Yeah.
I saw there's a kiosk. There's a kiosk in Pretoria which will be rolled out. You can walk in there, you can stick your fingerprint in, it verifies your fingerprint on Home Affairs, and you can register a company there and actually get your name registration, pay 175.
Is it one kiosk, Rand. Minister?
It's going to be rolled out. There's a major process of introducing ICT and simplifying the process built on the New Companies Act, which we put into practice in 2011. So I think that company registration is getting a lot easier than it has been. It can be done now by walking into the branch of one of Dennis's competitors and opening a business bank account.
We will be watching that index ranking on that one, Minister, definitely. We need...
In fairness, you know, when you go back to the World Economic Forum competitiveness industries, I mean, banks are ranked third.
Yeah.
But if you look at financial inclusion and finance accessibility of finance, it is listed as a disadvantage of doing business in South Africa. You know, in other words, there's not enough financial inclusion.
Yeah.
And I really do think that banks need to actually address that. I can do a little bit of advertising now because Nedbank is doing a big drive on small business at the moment.
But unfortunately, it's going to be harder now with the fall of African Bank, without doubt about that. Okay, let's get the comment from the lady. The microphone is not with her. Let's give the microphone to someone who's got a question. Okay, let's honor the lady first and then we'll come to you, sir. Thank you very much.
In terms of one of our biggest sectors being engineering and chemicals, et cetera, and minerals, and how do we find it, or how do we make it more attractive to young individuals to go into these sectors? Because the other industries obviously seem a little bit more better and it's easier to get into them. And so especially for women as well, it seems pretty hard and above and beyond having to study all and getting through your qualifications, but actually getting into the industry dominated by men and it not being a very attractive and feminine-oriented industry. How do we make that more attractive to the youth? Mm. And also, not to make it just about a money thing, in order for you to be able to really be included into the sector and really be involved in it and to holistically want this to grow for yourself and your country, as opposed to just upping the numbers and the economy and just making it a numbers game. So how do we do that for the economy and for the country?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, a lot of the skills development is not directly a responsibility of the DTI, but we do have a program where I was aware of one statistic as a result of launching it in Cape Town a few months ago, and that is that if you have got tertiary education, you've gone through one or other course in, for example, Cape Peninsula University of Technology, and you've got a degree, if you have had experience, you have a 2.3 times better chance of getting a job than if you've just got the degree. And so one of the programs that we've introduced is an internship mentorship program. in people that are benefiting from our industrial policy incentives. We put something in the kitty to employ people who are graduates precisely in those kinds of areas. So that's our coming to the party. We also do support a whole lot of other skills development programs in other industries, as well as our incentives and a proportion for skills development. I think we take this extremely seriously, but that's just one example of trying to address that particular challenge, because it is a real challenge.
Thank you,
of people getting formal qualifications but then not being able to find the real opportunities as a result of that.
You want to contribute?
Yeah, just one thing. I think the thing that the Minister has made, if it's what, 2.3
times better chance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you see it also in your stats?
Yeah, but the thing that the Minister didn't make a point, I mean, I think DTI can do something, but what it tells you is that government or education, the education system can't actually provide you the 2 times. Somebody out in industry must actually take you in. Yeah. And I think this is the message for industry. That 2.3 times can't be created by government. It can't be created by institutions. Mm. It has to be created by industry itself.
Yeah, important point. Okay, let's go to the back.
My name is Gusnatim Caesar. My question is dedicated to the minister. Minister, you would remember one of Africa's greatest sons who once said, Europe may have shown the world how to be industrial, but Africa still has an opportunity to show the world how to have a more human face. Minister, you quoted that tourism is one of our growing industries. In fact, depending on which stat we look at, it is said that currently the tourism industry is competing, if not exceeding, the raw minerals industry currently in the country. My question, therefore, is as follows. In that context, Minister, how are we leveraging the strengths that as South Africa and as the African continent are utilizing within the country to grow the economy? We know that South Africans are an active nation, and maybe some of the protest is because of the energy that is built within ourselves. But secondly, how are we then, if you look at the Americans, when they say they're American, it doesn't matter whether they're Hispanic or whatever, when they say they're American is because they believe. How are we then harnessing that energy into saying, South Africans, these are the things we are great at. South Africans, these are the beneficiations that we've been talking about as the Department of Minerals and Energy since 2006. But how are we now getting from words to actions that inspire a nation, whether it's my grandmother or it is a guy who's sitting in Cape Town at an auditorium like this, to move into action? Because South Africa and Africa has a human face, and that's one of our strengths.
Thank you. Well, it's all yours, Minister.
Let me just say that I was trying to make the point earlier on, but I do think that it's true that most of the jobs that are created in many economies are service jobs. But those service jobs are actually much more strongly rooted, much more secure, and of a higher quality if they're part of a diversifying productive sector of an economy. There's very high growth multipliers between manufacturing and service jobs. So I think that I was saying that that's even true of something like tourism. Now, how does South Africa? I mean, I think that we do need to project ourselves much more positively than we do. That's what I think is the issue. Half of us are wanting to snipe at the other half of us, and I think what we're doing half the time is we're trying to damage the reputation of the country. I think in many cases, when I go abroad and I talk to potential investors, recently just from the United States, what they look at is the African integration story, the industrialization story in Africa, and are quite positive about the fact that they need to step up their game in Africa, and that South Africa is a critical part of that. The sort of discourse you get in South Africa, you wouldn't believe that that is the case. You'd believe that everybody's coming to say, I'm not coming here any longer because of this, that, and the other problem. I think we shoot ourselves in the foot very often, and we don't have that sense of common purpose, of brand South Africa, and of working together. I think if we want to succeed, we better start creating that and get it off our high horses and start working together and create a much more inclusive economy, inclusive society, in which everyone can realize their own potential.
Quick comment, Minister. One of the rumblings that we heard ahead of Washington was that the American Congress might not be amenable to continue to include South Africa within AGOA. What did you find?
Well, the U.S. Congress will be the body that takes a decision ultimately about the future of AGOA.
Yeah.
We met with members of the U.S. administration, a number of members of Congress from both sides of the aisle, Most of those people that we spoke to were quite positive about the possibility of South Africa being continued to be included in AGOA. Nothing is final until the last gavel hits the table, but I think I came out of those engagements in the United States saying that I think that there's a much better and brighter prospect that South Africa will continue to be part of the Africa Growth and Opportunity Act than I felt perhaps before I went. So I think that we're on the right track, and I think that it would be very important for all of us in South Africa to say that it's important that we remain in this arrangement. What it has done is it has delivered a growing trade relationship with the United States, relatively balanced with about 60 billion rand of trade both ways, and it includes a proportion of value-added products from South Africa in the basket. If we were to sit out at the beginning and say, this, what do we want to achieve from a trade relationship, I think these are the kind of things we'd say need to be part of it. My message in the United States, to use a phrase of theirs, it ain't broke, we don't need to fix it, we need to renew it and roll it over and include South Africa in it. And I think if we all are saying that, we enhance our possibilities of achieving that goal at the end of the day.
We wish you well, Minister, in that journey. You want to quickly add before we take our final question somewhere here?
I mean, there was an important question that I think was asked about tourism. For instance, if you're sitting here in the Western Cape, tourism is the second biggest contributor to the Western Cape economy. So tourism as a contributor to South Africa, it's very, very important.
Yeah.
But I think the one thing that we always think about when we think about tourism is South Africa must be beautiful for other people. South Africa must be beautiful for us first.
Sure.
So I think what we need to do is actually to encourage us South Africans to actually take much more cognizance of what we have to offer to the rest of the world.
Right.
It is always nice when they come in with the hard currencies, and we welcome them very much. But I think South Africa must become beautiful for its own people. Mm. Just one last thing. I think Felix made this point in passing, is that we South Africans have a tendency to see ourselves as being kind of second class. We don't see ourselves as, well, we're playing in this game and we can play the game with everybody else on equal terms. Mm. And I think it's one area where we need to step up and actually believe in our own country and take just as much interest in it as anybody else.
Okay. Final question from you. Yes.
Okay. My name is Bongani Pire. I'm from Masile Secondary School. Okay, from the minister, I wish to ask that what could be the possible advantage of privatizing of one of our state-owned enterprises, which is the Eskom, like Nigeria? Thank you.
Okay. Okay, I'm not sure about the Nigeria part, but yeah. What did you say, Minister, about privatizing Eskom as a way of solving the energy issues?
I think the important thing that we need is we need the balance sheets and the capacities of these state-owned companies to drive an infrastructure investment program. We can't afford to just look at the luck of the game. Eskom's got a very critical role to play. It needs to be something which is part of the infrastructure build program, and I think I would need to receive a lot of persuasion that any other model is going to work, to be quite honest. So I'm not in support.
Okay. Minister, it's very clear. Dennis?
I think what should be considered, though, is opening up the energy sector to more private capital and expertise, which government, in fairness, has already done through REFIT, through the renewable energy area. What I would like to see is actually more opening up to perhaps the third coal-fired power station or something like that. There's no reason why that shouldn't go out and auction,
right?
So that at least we have some competitiveness in the industry and we can actually judge the quality and the speed of new capacity coming online.
Yeah, I was going to say that as a non-economist, I would say, why can't I buy shares in Eskom and then that money is used to roll out the infrastructure that Eskom requires instead of going abroad and trying to find that money from the bond market internationally. Anyway, that's a discussion for another day. Let's get our closing comments from all of you guys in terms of what key issues need to be addressed very quickly, 30 seconds for each of you, if we are to make South Africa a more competitive nation. I'll start with you and then move internally.
I think it's creating a platform that enables us to be competitive. If we've got a strategy to add maximum value, then we need to incentivize that. So as, again, we rely on government on providing those incentives to enable us to invest in our businesses. Policy is also critical in terms of looking at particular industries globally and seeing, for you to be competitive in certain industries, you need scale. And with scale, you need to be able to acquire and do what you need. You need to be able to get bigger. And I think sometimes in South Africa, bigger is seen as bad. And that notion, it doesn't need to be there. It's not necessarily bad. It enables you to be competitive. And as an exporter in particular, you can penetrate new markets and you can be successful. As I've said it before, as South Africans, I don't think we need to stand back anywhere. I think we are as good as anybody else. And we need to be able to invest in our businesses. And to do that, we need to make profits. I mean, that's the important part. And I don't think profits must be seen necessarily as a bad thing in South Africa too. So in closing, I think that, I think we can be competitive. I think in certain sectors we are competitive. And I also think credit needs to go to government because many of the things that are happening behind the scenes do benefit us. A lot of these negotiations with the EPA, AGOA, et cetera, et cetera, we need that. And a lot of work is done. And I think as South Africans, we complain a bit too much.
Sure. It's not quite broken, Dennis.
No, look, I think if you take a snapshot of South Africa, it's got many, many advantages. Great institutions, pretty good infrastructure. I mean, we're griping about electricity at the moment, but if we look at the roads and rail infrastructure and so forth, it's pretty much world class. Mm-hmm. I think that it just requires a few refinements, and my big plea at the moment would really be around consistency of government policy. We've got some very supportive policies, which help business and encourage business, but we do get almost like a schizophrenic mix sometimes whereby property rights are apparently back on the table and that, I think, causes a lack of investor confidence, which means that we don't actually scale up. We don't actually see the investment that we should.
Sure. Eben?
The first thing, I think it's more of the same thing. We need to believe in ourselves. I think we have sufficient examples that indicate that we are very good. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we forget that the BHP Billitons of this world and the Anglo-Americans, they might be listed in London, but they actually started from here.
Sure.
Your MTNs.
BHP is coming back.
Oh, yeah. So I think we need to believe in ourselves, in our capability.
Sure.
And there are enough indications that show that South Africans are very, very good in a whole range of dimensions. Then the second thing is to then actually upskill our people, especially the young. I think somebody mentioned it was Fred earlier on. I think the young...
Yes, the young lady.
Yeah. I mean, young people in South Africa are taking a kind of a backseat, and they shouldn't be. I mean, we like to say they are our future, but actually we must make them our future. I mean, it's great opportunities for our young people. Mm. That's very, very, very important. Then the last thing for me, I think we as a country must behave as a country. It's not them and us. It's us together. And then actually, I think that's, to me, is what's needed, that the business... It's not against the government and not against labor. Labor is not against government and labor. That we all actually are in this together and need to actually make it work for all of us.
SA Inc.
Well, I would say I think that raising competitiveness is a continuous process. Quite a lot of it has to happen at the level of individual companies and individual industries. And our role as government is to support that where we can through the incentives and through other programs and through creating the space for that to take place. And then also to address some of the bigger macro issues, like, as I mentioned right at the beginning, energy, skills development, and to create the market opportunities for participation in international trade. Mm-hmm. But I think our focus and our attention has been on the African continent, and I think for very, very good reasons. And it's very important, I think, that we do develop a sense of belonging together as a country, and that whatever disagreements we may have among ourselves, whatever disagreements we may have as social partners, should not, in the end of the day, I think, create conditions that do not allow us to do what many other countries do, which is to come together in external fora to promote the country and its many, many qualities, which others see, even if we don't see them ourselves.
Absolutely. So what is clear is that there ought to be a national dialogue, and this national dialogue ought to be very honest in order to be able to take this country forward. On that remark, we have to end the debate for today, but I think what is very clear is that the conversation might must start and it must be strengthened and it must involve all social partners. And certainly, I think from all of us, we'll be looking forward to next month when the World Economic Forum's Global Competitiveness Index is going to be published. Interestingly, we want to see where South Africa ends. From all of us here, good evening.